Mr. Niebel, you've just returned from Egypt, or rather post-revolutionary Egypt. What were your impressions and feelings?
You do see that the country is facing a new beginning. Egypt is taking its first steps towards democracy, but it's uncertain where it will end up. So I think it's important for us to offer our support, to offer a kind of shopping list. Then Egypt can choose what help it needs. But we must avoid creating the impression that the democratization process is determined by the West. Anyway, there was a very positive atmosphere there.
Do you already have contacts in the new Egypt?
Yes. First, there's the interim government, which includes a minister for international cooperation, a woman, who I deal with. We discussed a lot of measures we can implement together. We also have to talk openly about measures that we can't run jointly. So we do have government partners who we know already, for example, through our work with party political foundations, which are a uniquely German instrument. And there are many in society, not just politicians, but also from within the pro-democracy and liberation movement who can play an important part. And they are also among the contacts we've made.
Is there a more open atmosphere for dialogue?
It was completely relaxed. But I didn't feel restricted during my last visit, although that was with government representatives. I think that people are now much more open, freer. We were on Tahrir Square, and people came up to us and asked us who we were, where we came from, what we were doing, and why the Egyptian foreign minister wasn't with us. And we said, maybe it's too crowded for him here. That couldn't have happened just a few weeks ago. There is more openness. But this is just the beginning.
But it is remarkable for a foreign minister and development aid minister to go walkabout in central Cairo, isn't it?
I suppose it is, yes. But it's more remarkable that a foreign minister, a development minister, and the tourism commissioner from the economics ministry travel to a country with a clear message that we see it as our responsibility to stand by this country and offer support. A historic window of opportunity has opened up. I think the recent and ongoing events, which may also spread to who knows where, will change the political landscape of the world as we know it, and we should have a part in that.
I'm sure it's too early to judge, but do you at least hope that a democratic, multi-party political landscape can develop in Egypt?
I do hope so. There already were opposition parties, at least after the last elections, just not represented in parliament. Other parties will be formed, especially by young people. Three already have been. It's hard to say how long they will last, but we're very willing to help them set up if they want. But I don't think it's necessarily the state's job. We can and do offer support by financing political foundations. But it should really take place at the grassroots level, not the state-to-state level.
What did you find people expect of Germany?
They have high expectations. Germany has a consistently good reputation. That's the only way to describe it. We have a very, very good reputation. We're seen as a very welcome and trusted partner in Egypt. We won't be able to satisfy all their wishes, especially those of a financial nature. But the main expectations are not money-related. They have to do with capacity building, knowledge transfer, which would enable the Egyptians, who are a proud people, to shape their republic, their revolution, their democracy themselves. And we have a lot to offer in that respect.
Did you take actual financial aid to Egypt with you?
I commissioned an initial fund during the Jasmine Revolution in Tunisia. We've now set up three funds for the Middle East: a democratization fund, an education fund, and an economic fund. Because those are the three areas we need to work on to create a positive future. We can use the democratization fund to support the pro-democracy movement, but only if that help is welcome. For example, our International Cooperation Organization can help draw up electoral law and teach officials how to run an election where the result is not known beforehand. The Education Fund aims to raise people's skills level. Egypt has an educated elite, but most young people, and 65% of Egypt's population are under 25, are not properly educated. There's a lack of skilled workers. So we've provided funds for training for the future. That needs to be combined with a third fund. It will help provide jobs for people after their training. The fund will help banks grant loans, either microcredit for small entrepreneurs, or loans for existing companies that can't get loans on the normal market, and of course for startups.
People are fascinated by the wave of pro-democracy movements in North Africa and the Arab world. Will the new North Africa become a focus point for German development policy?
No, because most of those countries don't lack money. Sub-Saharan Africa will remain the main focus of our development policy. But we do have a lot to offer North Africa. We're a major partner for the region, and not only with taxpayers' money, which we only resort to where other options don't exist. That happens when a country simply isn't rich enough, like Egypt, for example, or where civil groups don't have the wherewithal to build a state from scratch and need funds to get started. We operate through our International Cooperation Organization, because many of these countries have the same needs as developing countries, but also have the funds to pay for them. So we're happy to meet that demand.
Do you think everything possible should be done to prevent a flood of refugees coming from those countries?
Absolutely. We must offer these people the prospect of a future in their own country and also a payoff in terms of liberty. A nation that rises up against a dictator needs to see the advantages that brings. So it's important they stay in their home country and help rebuild it. They need to create a new and viable state, and so all the human resources, the people and their skills are needed. It's in the interest of those countries to make sure people have the opportunities that will keep them at home.
You mentioned the positive feelings connected with experiencing a pro-democracy revolution. Does the situation in Libya worry you?
It's very worrying. On the way to Egypt, 10,000 meters above Libya, we saw flashes of light for about 20 minutes. It wasn't a weather phenomenon, because they were moving upwards from the ground and not the other way around. And the weather radar was clear. We still don't know if it was artillery or not. It can't have been fireworks, because you wouldn't see it from that distance. It was very worrying, and I hope that as few people as possible come to harm there. But the calls for freedom are very clear, and they will prevail in Libya.
Mr. Niebel, thank you for speaking to us.
Thank you.